Hello everyone, welcome to the ninth session in this lecture series on genetics and molecular biology. I'm Dr. Yogesh Pawde. Hope you all have subscribed to the channel and made all notifications available to you. This session is also under BI 7.1 and now we are moving on to structure of miscellaneous RNAs. In this particular lecture, we are going to discuss about snRNA, miRNA, siRNA and piRNA. The specific learning objectives of this session are: at the end of the session, phase 1 MBBS students shall be able to describe structure of snRNA, miRNA, siRNA and piRNA, and we are going to compare between DNA and RNA. Coming to small nuclear RNAs, these small nuclear RNAs or snRNAs are different from sRNA. S means soluble. So that soluble RNA is just tRNA, okay, and snRNA is small nuclear RNA. This variety of RNA constitute about 1 to 2% of total RNAs in a cell and have about 30 different varieties and are quite stable in the system. They are U1, U2, U3, U4, U5, U6 and on. What is most important about this miscellaneous RNA is the function which they are subserving. So here the snRNAs help in intron removal and the processing of snRNA into mRNA and gene regulation. In the process of removal of intron and processing of snRNA into mRNA, that is maturation of mRNA and gene regulation, these small nuclear RNAs have a very important role. So, in post-transcriptional modification particularly, small nuclear RNAs have a critical role. They bridge together the two exons that flank an intron. After removal of the intron, they bring together the two exons. They help in joining the two exons after removal of the intron. This is the structure of spliceosomal protein, the RNA complex where U1 is binding hairpin 2 of U1 snRNA. Ribonucleoprotein complexes with snRNA are called as small nuclear ribonuclear proteins, abbreviated as SNRPs. And there are examples of snRNAs. U1 snRNA produces correct 3' end of histone mRNA, which lacks a poly A tail. Now here histone mRNA lacks poly A tail. So it needs the correction of its 3' end of histone mRNA. We have seen the significance of 3' end protected by poly A tail. But when histone mRNA do not have poly A tail, how its 3' end needs to be corrected? So here U7 snRNA produces correct 3' end of histone mRNA, okay, even though it lacks poly A tail. 7 skRNA associates with SNRP, modulates mRNA gene transcription and elongation by RNA polymerase 2. So here the post-translational modification and gene modulation of mRNA gene transcription. So here 7 skRNA helps in that. So to conclude, what is the role of snRNA is intron removal and processing of snRNA into mRNA and its gene regulation, and bringing together the two exons that flank an intron. So remember the function of snRNA. Coming to microRNA or mRNA. So I'll be referring microRNAs as mRNA in this session. Its structure is just a single stranded RNA of about 21 to 23 nucleotides. The formation and processing. The mRNA act like traditional transacting regulators, encoded by a gene but act on other gene, okay, like snRNAs. What is mean by transacting regulator is gene for mRNA is different and gene for microRNA is different. When microRNA is encoded by a gene but that gene is different, they act on other gene which produces mRNA. The genes encoding microRNAs are much longer than the process mature miRNA molecules. Genes are longer than the actual length of the mRNA, right? Because of splicing of introns. and there are untranslated region at 5 prime end and 3 prime end also. But here that difference is much significant here because gene is very long and the mature miRNA molecules are very small. Small but very important, and they have a very crucial role in regulating activity or the translation of mRNAs. Now let us see how they are formed or transcribed. This is microRNA gene. After transcription, this kind of structure, which is known as pri-miRNA, pri-miRNA means primary transcript of miRNA. This structure is formed. You can see here stem loop structure of first transcribed as primary transcript with a cap and a poly A tail process to short 70 nucleotide stem loop structure. This primary transcript is going to be cropped by a microprocessor protein complex, which consists of nuclease drosha and double-stranded RNA binding protein called as PASHA. So drosha nuclease and PASHA protein will crop this primary transcript into this pre-miRNA. Pre-mRNA will be synthesized by the action of microprocessor protein complex, which consists of nuclease drosha and protein PASHA, and this poly A tail and capping will be removed here. Only the stem and the loop will be present in pre-mRNA structure. After that, this pre-mRNA will be exported from nucleus to cytoplasm. This pre-mRNA are then processed to mature miRNAs by interaction with endonuclease dicer. This endonuclease dicer will remove the loop of this stem loop structure. So this loop will be removed by a dicer, or we can say a dicer is what? A cutter. That is endonuclease dicer. And this will initiate the formation of RNA induced silencing complex. After cleavage of this, you will see a just stem. Because the nucleotide base pairs are complemented to each other, they are forming a duplex of one miRNA and another miRNA. Both the strands of this duplex are potential miRNAs. Remember, once they will be separated, each of the two will be potential mRNA depending on the target sequence. If some other gene or some other mRNA has a sequence complementary to this strand of this duplex, okay, so it will act on that gene, and the other one which has a sequence complementary to pink one will be acted upon by this pink mRNA. And this functional miRISC, that means RNA induced silencing complex, will act on that particular gene which has the complementary sequence. Now you will understand why these microRNAs are very small. Because smaller the molecule, more are the chances of its complementarity with the target gene. If it is longer, chances of complementarity will be less. Okay, so that's why it is very small. But more smaller the molecule, more is the specificity. This is a structure of miRNA. We have seen that the cleavage of drosha and PASHA will act upon this part of the stem loop structure will be removed. Basal segment and lower stem will be removed by drosha. And next step, dicer will act on this terminal loop and this will also be removed. Now only this part. This is mature miRNA, and we have seen both the strands of the duplex are potential miRNA. So upper stem of only 22 base pair in the final mature miRNA are there. Each strand of this duplex will be a mature miRNA. So see the size of the final product, it is only 22 base pairs. So this 22 base pairs can find complementarity to 70% or 80% of the sequence, but it is very specific, a target gene sequence or target miRNA. These are the examples of microRNAs. The structure of some pre-miRNA before processing to generate the mature miRNA. The sequence in red are miRNAs. These are miRNAs, right? So miR1 and miR34. In some cases, both arms of the stem loop can generate a functional miRNA that we have discussed, depending on the complementarity to the sequence. Okay. In such cases, the second miRNA is shown in blue. For example, miR1 in red and miR1 in blue, as well as with miR34 red and miR34 in blue. Both are potentially functional miRNAs depending on the complementarity with the target gene. The RNA-induced silencing complex, RISC complex, is responsible for the gene silencing observed due to mRNA expression and RNA interference. These are the two mechanisms responsible for gene silencing. The small processed mature mRNAs typically hybridize via the formation of imperfect RNA-RNA duplexes within the 3' UTR regions of specific target mRNAs, leading to translation arrest. So did you understand this? These smaller sequences of mRNA, because of its complementarity, they hybridize the specific sequences of 3' UTR regions of specific target mRNAs. The functions of mRNAs are, they alter the function of mRNA, they inhibit the gene expression. mRNAs are negative regulators of target mRNAs. Once messenger RNAs are transcribed, there will be a transcription of microRNAs also in the same system, chromatin. It results in the destruction of these messenger RNAs, or they prevent their translation depending on the degree of complementarity. MicroRNAs inhibit expression of homologous target genes in three ways. They trigger destruction of the messenger RNA encoded by the target gene, or inhibit translation of the messenger RNA, or induce chromatin modifications within the target gene, thereby silencing its transcription process. It depends how closely the guide RNA matches the target mRNA. If the sequences are highly complementary, as is usually the case with siRNA, small interfering RNAs, the target is degraded. If the match is not as good, as there are several base pairing mismatches, as it is often in the case with microRNAs, the response is more often inhibition of translation. Okay. Then coming to small interfering RNAs, siRNAs. Those are derived by the specific nucleolytic cleavage of larger double-stranded RNAs. To produce small siRNAs or siRNAs of 21 to 23 nucleotides, the short siRNAs usually form perfect RNA-RNA hybrids because it is highly complementary with their distinct targets, potentially anywhere within the length of the mRNA where the complementary sequences exist. So it is not necessary that complete mRNA will be hybridized. Depending on the complementary sequences in the mRNA, anywhere in the length of mRNA, if it binds and hybridizes perfectly without any mismatch of the base pairs, they will exert their effect of destruction of mRNA. Formation of such duplexes of siRNA and mRNA result in reduced specific protein production, that is inhibition of translation. The siRNA mRNA complexes are degraded by specific nucleolytic machinery. Once siRNA hybridizes with mRNA, the specific nucleolytic machinery is there which will degrade that complex, and so the mRNA will be destroyed. Some or all of these mRNA degradation occurs in specific cytoplasmic organelles called as P bodies. So all this binding or hybridization of siRNA with mRNA complex and its cleavage by specific nucleolytic machinery is happening inside P bodies. Those are the organelles present in cytoplasm. The distinction worth making between mRNA and siRNA is that the former act like traditional transacting regulator. The mRNA act like traditional transacting regulator. They are encoded by a gene but acting on other gene. In contrast, siRNAs are typically generated by transcripts of the region on which they act. So they are generated or encoded by the gene which is producing mRNA itself. So the same gene is producing siRNA also when it is producing mRNA. So they are like antisense RNAs. and thus described as working in cis rather than trans. So trans is Mirna and Sirna is cis. Coming to PV interaction RNAs, the PV interaction RNAs or PIRNAs, PIRNAs, express predominantly in the germline. The PIRNAs usually have 24 to 34 nucleotides and are derived without involving dsRNA, double stranded RNA precursor. They are generated by processing long single-stranded transcript. The long single-stranded transcript will undergo modification or cleavage to produce PIRNAs, PIRNAs. PIRNA do not require the cleavage by diazer of a long single-stranded transcript. They bind an ergonaut-related protein called as PV within an RISC-like complex. PIRNAs particularly protect cells from transposons and predominantly expressed in germline. The PIRNA clusters contain pieces of transposons. Transposons are what? Jumping genes, right? They're called as transposon graveyards. So what are the effects this transposon going to have will be inhibited by PIRNAs. The PIRNAs are generated from transcripts of transposons regions only. The same transposon region will transcribe transposons as well as PIRNAs. So these PIRNAs will target transcripts made by active transposons, inhibit their action. What is the difference between siRNA and piRNA is the mode or the mechanism of synthesis of piRNAs. That is different. They do not require diazer and they do not require and they bind an ergonaut related protein called as PV within a RISC like complex. That is the difference between piRNA and siRNA. Now coming to the summary of target and effect of small RNAs. Small nuclear RNA target hnRNA, okay, and the effect is hnRNA processing into mRNA is the effect which will be inhibited, and the gene regulation will be seen as an effect of snRNA. Coming to Mirna, Mirna act on mRNA, mature mRNAs, right? They block mRNA translation and destabilize RNAs after hybridization. Then coming to small interfering RNA, that is Sirna, they act on mRNAs or they can act on nascent transcripts of chromosomal regions. When they act on mRNA, they will show effect of blocking translation or destabilizing mRNAs like Mirna. And when they act on nascent transcripts of chromosomal region, they recruit histone modifying enzymes to DNA and destined to become heterochromatin, resulting in heterochromatin formation. So this is the function of Sirna, where it modifies the chromatin by acting on nascent transcripts of chromosomal regions. Then coming to PIRNA, they have a target of transposable element transcripts or transposable element promoters. So both are the targets of PIRNA. When they act on transposable element transcript, they degrade the transposable element mRNA, the transcripts of transposons, and when they act on transposable element promoter, they facilitate histone modifications that inhibit transposable element transcription. So here also the chromatin modification component is there. Both of these mechanisms are going to inhibit expression of transposons by inhibiting its transcription. This was regarding small RNAs. Now let us compare DNA versus RNA. In this RNA, we are going to consider messenger RNA, ribosomal RNA, transfer RNA, that is tRNA, then all the other miscellaneous RNAs we are going to consider in this, and we are going to compare that with DNA. In DNA, there is a presence of 2-deoxyribose sugar, and in RNA, we have ribose sugar. Then in DNA, there is presence of thymidylate, and there is absence of uracil and other nucleotides which are present in RNA. We have seen that in messenger RNA, there are presence of methylpurines and methylpyrimidines. In tRNA, we have seen that there are pseudouridines present. The absence of thymidylate is seen in RNA except in tRNA, where we find presence of thymidylate in T-psi-C loop. There is presence of uracil and other nucleotides in RNA. DNA is stable due to absence of oxygen at 2 prime carbon. Lesser number of oxygen, more is the stability. But because oxygen is present at 2 prime carbon atom of RNA, it because it has ribose sugar, so it is unstable. Its half-life is very short and it is very unstable because of RNase is acting on 2 prime carbon atom of ribose sugar. DNA has two helical strands, purine and pyrimidine contain are almost equal, they follow the Cherenkov's rule. In RNA, RNAs are single-stranded, though there are frames and loops in between, but usually they are single-stranded and purines and pyrimidines are not equal. Half-life of spontaneous hydrolysis in DNA is about 200 million years. So it is stable just because it does not have one oxygen at 2 prime carbon atom of ribose sugar in DNA structure. The possibility of mutations occurring and remaining unidentified is more with uracil, since cytosine can be easily deaminated to uracil, and because of which, you know, the RNA viruses, they mutate so frequently and sometimes they remain unidentified because the sequence changes so fast. So the mutations are so prevalent in RNA viruses. DNA becomes more suitable storehouse of genetic information. These are the references which have been taken in consideration to prepare the presentation. I recommend you to go through these references for further studies and more detailed picture of the miscellaneous RNAs. I thank you very much for watching the video. I request you to like and share the video and subscribe to the channel if you are not yet subscribed to the channel, and make all the notifications available to you for the upcoming videos in this lecture series. Thank you so much. Keep watching, keep learning, and keep motivating us. Thank you.